So, good morning to all of you. Thank you for being here. I would like to tell you this is the last session of ImProtect 2019, and we are very pleased to receive our last keynote speaker from the States, Gary Hagberg, who is an author, professor, philosopher, and jazz musician. So he's a specialist in playing performing jazz, but also in aesthetics and ethics of the music. He is currently a professor of philosophy and aesthetics at Bard College. And I would like to say that at Bard, he teaches specialized courses on the philosophy of the arts and the history of aesthetic thought, the philosophy of language since 1900, yes. Pragmatism and the development of 20th century philosophy, in addition to courses on issues and authors from Plato and Aristotle to the present day. Hagberg is an accomplished jazz guitar player, and he is member of the Atlantic Jazz Trio, which tours in Europe and the United States. How can you manage to be professor and musician at the same time? It's very difficult. So, welcome, Gary. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. For those of you who just came in, there's a handout on the table. I hope there are enough to go around. If there aren't, maybe you can sit together. The handout makes an outline of the talk, of the ground I'd like to cover in the next 45 minutes. I did have a paper prepared to read, but this has been such an enjoyable set of conversations, I thought it made more sense in this case to just sort of talk through the main points, and that'll leave time for us to have a discussion after my remarks. I also want to say what an honor it is to be invited to kick off, to be here in the first place, and to kick off the day devoted to philosophical and ethical issues concerning our interaction with digital entities. I'll say more about what I mean by that phrase at the end of my talk today. So I want to thank everyone who made this happen. I wanted to begin with this kind of issue. It's an issue about intention and about what intention is. We all know that the performance of music is an intentional activity. It certainly isn't an accidental one. And so we want to ask, well, in philosophy, one wants to ask, well, what is that intentional content? How do we describe it? The first intuition that we might have is that minds, human minds, have intentions. And human minds are, after all, as we think of it, hermetically sealed inside their own sort of conscious boundaries. So the picture, the philosophical model of mental privacy, in a sense, comes first. And that picture, once in place, then gives rise to the question, well, what about collective ensemble action? What about working together in an ensemble in such a way where something emerges from the inside of the ensemble that is not reducible to individual intention? Now, I'll say much more about that as we proceed. But it seems as though some work in ensemble playing transcends the metaphysical boundary between the inner and the outer. So right there, we begin with a kind of a puzzle. Well, I wanted to then begin by looking at an idea that Arthur Danto, the American philosopher, died a few years ago, very influential in the history of modern aesthetics. Danto came up with what I would call a subtractive method in philosophical aesthetics, and he was trying to ask a much more general question about, well, what is art? And his method was to look at the case of Andy Warhol's Brillo Box and to ask, what's the difference between what he called a mere real thing, that is a cardboard box that Brillo pads were shipped out from the factory in, and Andy Warhol's book that was visually indistinguishable, at least at a distance, visually indistinguishable from the mere real thing. And Danto thought, well, if we, in a sense, subtract the sensory experience of the Brillo box from the experience of the aesthetic object, We'd in a sense have a remainder. And that remainder would then be, in a sense, the content or the intentional content of a work of art. Danto came up with the idea of that remainder being what he called the atmosphere of theory. And that's not terribly important for today, but what is important is the subtractive method. So I thought, well, let's transplant that idea from general philosophical aesthetics to the special case of ensemble interaction. And so in that case, I mean, it's not a direct transplant because I'm not asking the question, what is a musical work of art? That's Danto's question. My question here is, what is the remainder? What is the subtractive remainder? If we subtract all of the individual actions that happen on stage from the collective event that takes place, how then do we describe that remainder? So that's the nature of the philosophical question I wanted to start today with. Now, one origin of the problem, I think, tracing back, one origin of the problem actually comes from the history of philosophy, from none other than Thomas Hobbes and the social contract model. Now, this model, you know, there's the famous picture, you know, of all of the little individuals, right? Each little individual is making up this kind of imaginary collective person, but the point is that it's additive. The point is that any social collective is the sum total of the number of individuals who go to make it up. That's why that drawing of Hobbes' view is so famous. So if that's right, then the social contract model, deeply embedded in our intuitions about what a collective is, right, will house the metaphysical presupposition of autonomy, of individual autonomy, of people being contained inside our own minds in a way where all intentional content would then always be actually reducible back to individual mental activity. So it presupposes autonomy, and it promotes the presupposition that the sum of intentional content is actually then an added sum of individual content. And this is all called the additive model. Right? So we've got Danto's subtractive method. We've got now the social contract additive model of a social collection. So if you think of that view and then ask, well, what's a musical ensemble? What is it? You'd say, well, it's a social contract project, right? It's where people actually, in a sense, as psychologists say, de-individuate into a collective, but where, in fact, that de-individuation always preserves the metaphysical autonomy of the individual that we started with. And so what I want to suggest is, well, you can't get there from here. That is to say, you can't get at a description of what kind of thing is taking place in a creative ensemble where the ensemble work doesn't reduce to the sum total of individuals added together. You can't get there. So I want to suggest that my talk today, one of the things I wanted to suggest is to get at the remainder, right? To get at this subtractive remainder, stuff left over, I'll say much more about that in a moment, we need a different starting point, or really, to put it in linguistic terms, we need a different language, a different way of seeing this. Now, there's another related issue here, and it has to do with what I'll call the foreseeable problem. And the foreseeable problem in intention is that we imagine that in intentional activity that we can kind of foresee the entire result of the intended action. So if we think about how we explain unintended consequences, we say, well, wait, I didn't mean that, I didn't intend that, sorry that happened, all of those kinds of phrases, right, are designed to disavow the consequences that ensue from our action that were not intentional. So if that's in place as a common practice, think about what that presupposes. What that presupposes is what I call the foreseeable problem. What it presupposes is that an intention will be the kind of thing it can always be fully foreseen. So if we ask, well, what did a composer mean or intend or so on, what's the meaning of the work? Well, what's the meaning, what's the intentional content of the work? We then say, well, what was it that was intended within it? And we think that once we understand the individual intention, we'll understand the content of the work. I think that that presupposition is hasty. I think it's too fast. I think we need something else. So the idea of a shared intention, well, what I want to say is that if we have a shared intention, then any full pre-envisioning of that joint action is incompatible with group activity. So in a sense, if we start with these presuppositions philosophically, we'll kill the sense of adventure in an ensemble that we're trying to actually explain. So in Wordsworth's sense, it murders to dissect. In that sense, we would end up actually killing the live nature of ensemble creativity by coming into it with philosophical presuppositions of the kinds that I've been discussing. So where is a language then to discuss this, and where can we find a language that doesn't come in front-loaded with all of these sort of deadening presuppositions philosophically? Well, the philosopher Margaret Gilbert has written a lot on, there's a debate going on about the nature of collective intention and so on, and I think that this debate is helpful for us. The example she uses seems, I realize at first glance, it certainly seemed to me, childishly simple, right? You think, well, life's much more complex. Her example is two people walking together. And you think, well, that's going to tell us something about shared intention? I think actually it does. Because the standards we have of mutual attention, think about it, of mutual attention, think about the tracks in the sand. Think about the mutual attention back and forth. Think about the awareness of the other. Think about the interactive nature of walking together. Think about the endless subtle corrections that we make walking together. And let's contrast that case with, as happens on the street, all the time, happened yesterday, I was walking through Athens. Think about the difference between two people walking together and two people walking side by side who don't know each other. Now, to an outward viewer, they might say, well, on a behavioral level, it's the same thing. Not at all, I want to suggest, right? And I think Gilbert's right about this. The difference is not containable within one mind, and right there, something philosophically of interest, I think, happened. Right there, you say, wait, walking together, right, with all of the kind of finely attuned sensitivity to each other, right, what that takes, well, that's like a microcosm or a brief model, right, of what it is to have a co-owned intention, right, of a kind, of a special kind that actually resists the picture of metaphysical autonomy. Right? So if we think, well, what is that? It's a kind of conceptual corrective to the presupposition with which we approach the question of what is an ensemble doing? Right? Why is it creative in a way that is interesting? And I would go so far as to suggest that what that provides, however childishly simple it might seem to begin with, is actually an example, a microcosm of what happens on a far, far, far more complicated, intricate level in say, an improvising jazz ensemble. So the kind of joint intentional commitment, right, and action in play here, I would want to suggest is itself what logicians call primitive, or in philosophy, what that means, it's not amenable to further analysis or to reduction. So I've had philosophers ask me, wait, there's Gilbert's example of the two people walking together, it's much more complicated than we thought, etc. All that's fine, but then they say, but how do you break that down? And my question is, there's the mistake. The idea that we can break it down is to suggest that we can reduce down to individual, autonomous, hermetically contained intention on the part of the individual. And Gilbert's entire point is that, well, no, it's a shared intention. So this leads me, I'm now at point seven on my outline, this leads then to the merger, really, into what you might call a joint person, or as the phrase goes, a plural subject. I want to say later today, in a few minutes, that an ensemble of a certain kind is a plural subject. But anyway, it leads to a different kind of phraseology. A plural subject is the kind of thing where each member of an ensemble acts as if that person were a limb or an extension, really, of a single organism. Now, the language we use in such cases is, many of you, this room is full of extremely highly accomplished musicians, and so you know what it means to say, well, this is where the ensemble wanted to go, or this is where the music wanted to go, or we were playing, but it kind of wanted to go this other way, so we went with it. It wanted to go some other way? That's intentional language, right? But it's intentional language that is attributed to a collective that is not reducible to any individual. So our normal intentional language, right, is in a sense in play, but it's distributed. It's distributed across different individuals. And so the ensemble itself, in a way, can point the way. Now, if I may, just very quickly, I had the luxury of doing a quartets project. A small label came up with the idea of doing quartets with guitar, piano, bass, and drums on the west in the East Coast of the United States, guitar, sax, bass, and drums on the West Coast, and guitar and second guitar, bass, and drums in Germany. It was a lot of fun, and the condition of that session, organized by the label leader, was no rehearsal. And of course, so instantly everybody panicked, and he said, no, the point of this project, right, is to see what happens, right, see what happens in these collective groups, repositioning the guitar into these different ensemble settings. So very quickly, I just want to play an example, if I may. I'm not sure that what I want to suggest will be audible, and I'll come back to why I think that's important in a minute. But let me just play the example. We're playing the jazz standard, Thad Jones tune, A Child Is Born. And so, you know, here we are, you know, playing along through the changes. A lot of you here have done this at a very high level of achievement. So this phase is in a way predictable. It's a guitar player who's, you know, taking a solo over the changes. And the second guitar player is in a sense, you know, accompanying. But right here, something happens I want to talk about in a minute. And etc. So and so on and so forth. Now, the idea here, is that in the first half of that, if you're the jazz players here, will I think have already heard this and know exactly what I'm going to say. The first half of that is, I think, you know, predictable, and it's a player playing over the changes. But there's a transitional moment when I was trying in that session to pass the baton to the other guitar player for his solo, or to the bass player. For his, you know, and you know, anybody can play next. It's an open session on standards, and I tried to do that, but in a sense, it went into this place where it's as though the baton were floating in air in a way, and nobody knew exactly what to do, and that was instructive because rather than just saying, well, okay, we blew that take, let's go back and try again, there was a sense in which my intention individually was to close that solo one chorus earlier, and if you listen, you can hear me kind of closing it down, and it's very clear I'm about to hand this over in a predictable way. But then, where it turns into this collective thing, where nobody's making a decision, but the music wants to go in this other place, we all the other players are very accomplished players. They respond to that immediately, particularly the bass player, if you listen closely. And in that case, right, the music sort of goes in to this added added section, which, again, I'm not sure that you can hear it. Well, I can certainly hear it because I was there, but here's the thing. What I want to try to get at is the phenomenology, as philosophers call it, from inside the ensemble. And that's what I'd like to try to describe, that's what I'd like to try to find some language for. And that, in fact, way of speaking would have to then avoid the additive model, right? It's not the model of individual intention, and it would have to avoid the pre-envisionment problem, the foreseeing problem, right? Because a whole bunch of stuff happened on that record that in fact none of us predicted, as happens, I think, on every record, you know, every jazz record ever made. And so responding to that in the moment is often a matter of responding to an intention on the part of a collective that nobody actually intended. I want to just step into the paper I'm not reading for a moment. It's the passage on handout page 3. It would be easy to insist that joint commitments with which we're all familiar since childhood, walking together, are one thing, and the co-creation of a plural subject, a rather sophisticated metaphysical notion, is quite another. So I want to ask, do we really have the ability to co-create a plural subject without first understanding the subtractive problem and the search for the remainder, Danto's issue, without a comprehension of the influence of the social contract picture, what we just talked about with Thomas Hobbes, without a nuanced conception of the differences between psychological, intentional, and characterological ascriptions to an autonomous individual, and the extended use of that vocabulary to an irreducible collective entity? One might think the answer to this question must be negative. How could we co-create something of which we don't have an understanding? But one would be missing the point in asking this question with too limited a sense of what an understanding means. This came up in a very interesting talk yesterday. One could undertake an ethnographic study of jazz players in rehearsal, in performance, and in the recording studio, and document the extensive and precisely detailed language players have developed to address the collective intentional considerations discussed above. They don't use terms such as a plural subject, right? It'd be very weird to hear that phrase in a recording studio, but they certainly show, and here's the point, they certainly have a thoroughly developed grasp of this concept in their language about what they will do, what they want to do, and what they have done. But that's not the strongest point to make here in Gilbert's defense. Far stronger, and this is consistent with the American pragmatist tradition, the practices themselves, I want to suggest, show this concept in play. And this is true whether or not the concept can be verbally articulated. So this is non-propositional understanding. And it's of this kind, weaves itself through all the aspects of music making, teaching, learning, rehearsing, recording, and so forth. Non-propositional understanding in music is, I want to suggest, you all know this, everywhere, right? So in this sense, one argues back from the result. If ensembles achieve the results they do, and we have empirically before us as listeners and phenomenologically in the experience of the players, the irreducible remainder that makes the difference between a performance at the height of this art form and one that, shall we say, aspires to such heights, then the concept of the plural subject is underwriting, I want to suggest, the very possibility of this music. So to put it one way, the plural subject, that idea, has been, in a sense, the philosophical precondition of music of this kind. I want to turn next to the to an example from the Stan Getz Quartet. It's an example that serves my interests well. There are countless examples. We heard a lot yesterday. Countless examples of this, but mine happened to settle on their recording of Green Dolphin Street. And there are a lot of relevant details to the idea of collective intentional content in this recording. It's about 14 minutes long, the entire record, and we have to listen to it three times, so just listening would take up my entire time here. But I do have a couple of excerpts. But for now, there is the musical analog of implication, the idea of saying little but implying much, where everybody in the ensemble, its quartet, fully comprehends and then acts together on those implications. So this is what I want to call non-explicit shared intentional content. Now, right there, you say, wait, that kind of, what is that? Non-explicit shared intentional content? That's something that nobody says, but that they all do, right? So again, this my discussion, I hope, is pointing toward the issue of practices first. I'll come back to that at the end of my talk. And then the melody is being played and yet not being played. Every jazz player here knows what that means. It's stated or suggested with just one or a few notes in such a way that everybody, quote, hears in the mind's ear, right, that melody, but nobody's actually playing it. By the way, this morning, I remembered, I was listening to Sonny Stitt one night in a club, and he said, phenomenal, you know, jazz musician, and he said, we're going to play the standard Autumn Leaves, and many of you have played this kind of basic rudimentary jazz 101 tune, you know, and he picked up his horn, he's got this blistering quartet, he picks up his horn, and he, you know, the first line of that, you know, E, F sharp, G up to C, you know, classic melodic fragment. He picked up his horn. He played E up to C natural. And that's the last part of Autumn Leaves you heard. They then just went wild on the implication range of that interval, suggesting the first fragment of the melody that was never then played for the rest of the entire tune. One of the best performances of Autumn Leaves I ever heard. So the Getz ensemble is actually playing inside the range of implication in that way. They also, in fact, live with a sense of multiple possibilities. They're holding back and they're awaiting. They're awaiting a kind of group choice, a kind of ensemble chosen direction. You hear that throughout the piece. To play preemptively would be to not show sensitivity to the other in, quote, walking together, right? And so that would be a kind of reversion to the autonomy model. There's more to say about that, but we'll talk about that later. But in a sense, it would be like walking with a person who isn't responding to you, right? Where you're trying to keep up. You're trying to adjust yourself to that person's motion. That's not walking together. That's walking beside someone who's walking, right? And in fact, the Getz quartet in this example never does that. It's an interesting thing. It never happens. There's a masterful awareness of gaps between Getz's phrases that shows the influence of Lester Young, from those of you who know about his playing. And they, the other players, piano, bass, and drums, are commenting intelligently within the gaps between Getz's phrase. Now, what I want to say about this is it's actually more than that. It's not just that they're commenting intelligently in the kind of melodic gaps between his phrasing. It's not that. It's rather that it's there are four minds working their way through one solo. So if you look at it this way, you say, well, how many people are playing that solo? You say, well, Getz is soloing, right? Well, yes, true. But how many people are actually making an active contribution to that solo? Four. Would the solo that Getz is playing actually have its trajectory without that participation of the other members? The answer is no, right? So where's the intentional content? It's distributed, obviously, right? By the way, the trio beneath him, it's not accompaniment, right? That's the wrong concept. That's not what they're doing, right? And so this is, in a sense, there's a feeling of holding back, like horses waiting to charge out of the gate, you know? Well, this is all still, in a sense, in the initial part of this performance, and it's in the initial melodic statement, but in fact, what it does is to establish a sense of collective possibility, and it's as though it's simmering near a boil, and what you have there is a very interesting thing. You hear, everybody, if we had time, if we had, you know, 3 hours for this session, we could listen to it closely, everybody here would hear a kind of collective restraint. They're holding back initially, right? They're not playing everything that is possible. They're residing within a kind of potentiality that's not being activated, but everybody can hear that. And yet you say, well, where is it? Well, you can't point to any individual notes, any of sounds, because, of course, it's not in the sounds, right? In the same way that in a conversation, you can tell if someone is, in fact, exhibiting a kind of restraint, right? And you might want to solicit the further commentary from them. You want to draw them out, right? Well, why? Because you can tell that there's something inside the intentional content of that conversation that hasn't yet been articulated. Getz Quartet works exactly like that. They've worked together a lot. Exactly like that. And so I step back into my paper, this is the bottom of your page four, and this is where the piano solo begins. As the piano solo begins, the quartet is, of course, reduced to a trio, piano, bass, and drums, and it plays beautifully, but it does, for the first few choruses, show what it is for three players to work brilliantly together. But as three players, jointly intending, jointly committed. However, for the last chorus, we get the musical equivalent of lighter fluid suddenly being suddenly sprayed on what was a small fire. And it, as players say, is happening, no question about it. For the first part of this incendiary moment, the bass moves to a relentless, sustained, and rhythmically powerful pedal, like what we've heard before, but now with an aggressive stance that is inextricably intertwined with a piano line on top that, in a way, calls for this, right? So he's responding for something that's implicit, right? The drums join this with dynamic power on the same rhythmic accents of the bass, again, like one thinker thinking. So this, they together are like one thinker thinking. Now this pedal lasts long and it prepares the massive lift coming out of it that confirms this trio that has just now itself reintegrated into a plural subject. The repeated high-energy piano figures stretch the underlying harmony to a point, now seen here again, where the melodic and rhythmic fragments, both sequenced and powerfully syncopated in a 3-against-4 rhythm, the piece is in 4-4, assert their importance above and beyond what a conventional sense of inside playing could accommodate. conventional playing inside the given harmony of the changes. The collective intentional content of a plural subject need not remain within conventional limits. And like the quartet, now this trio unmistakably shows the difference as well within the reduced frame of the piano solo. The continuous, extremely rapid melodic lines placed together without breathing or breaks between only further fuel this fire. And the harmonic underpinning moving into chromatic harmony layered over the top of the chord progression now is more intimated than heard. This is a tiny fragment, but you'll hear immediately how much this implies. Brief, but now listen to this. There's the pedal I was talking about. And then handing the baton back to Guess. It's phenomenal playing. But that, I want to suggest, right, is a kind of musical logic, a kind of thematic logic. It's being worked out compositionally together. And what I want to suggest, if you listen to that closely, is that it's something like an emergent composer that is creating spontaneously. And what we start to do, right, in this record, what we start to do, or hearing them live, back in the day, hearing them live and so on, what we start to do, right, is to hear the ensemble as a single composer, composing spontaneously in a way where, of course, to use old traditional categories about composition, but you hear this kind of emergent composer where there's a kind of mentality coming out that is, once again, not reducible. So each individual is, in an audible sense, always aware of where they've come from together, and they're constantly mindful of that. And this, what I want to say, this mindfulness of each other, walking together, but extremely complicated, right, is in a sense where the intentional content of the collective reaches into the mind of each player. And so you say, well, wait a minute, now what's going on? Well, in that case, the hermetic seal of the conscious mind with which we started itself actually doesn't really function, right? It's not really a matter of intellectual privacy. So with all that in place, right, it's really... I just want to say, at the end of this performance, some of you might know it, the album won all kinds of awards and stuff. It was recorded live in Copenhagen and massively successful. Well, Goetz himself had received a medical diagnosis. He thought that was his last performance. He thought his time was very short. And at the end of that piece, the end of the record, you have a sense of that collective emergent composer from that quartet playing for what they thought was going to be their last time together. In fact, Goetz lived for 2 more years. The diagnosis was happily wrong. They thought it was their last performance together. And there's a sense of a gentle, almost sweet wave of goodbye at the end of this piece. Now, you might say that's fanciful. If you do think that, I would if I were hearing myself say this now. Listen to it, and you will hear this kind of emergent composer. But all this leads, I have to move quickly, all this leads to some remarks by a philosopher named Philip Pettit, who has developed his theory of the so-called group agent. And the fundamental idea, I'll be brief, is that collectives can exhibit rationality, and a collective can follow the trajectory or the emergent pattern of its own previous decisions and actions. Now, the interesting thing about this, what Pettit moves into beyond where we left it with Margaret Gilbert, the walking together example, is this. The content of the actions of the collective need not correspond to preferred individual decisions on the part of any single member, and indeed they can be in conflict with those intentions. So in that case, you have a kind of intentional activity, clearly discernible, which is not reducible to individuals, that we've got so far in play, but which can be actually incompatible with the individual intentions on the part of the members of that collective. So in fact, their collective rationality is in fact where an ensemble wants to go and so on, where the music wants to go, often not only different from or not reducible to individual intention, but where in fact it can be incompatible with those intentions. It's as though the collective or emergent composer in a sense takes over. Philip Pettit's there's a passage on page 5. He writes, there's a type of organization found in certain collectivities that makes them into subjects in their own right, giving them a way of being minded, exactly what I'm trying to talk about here, that is starkly discontinuous with the mentality of their members. This claim in social ontology is strong enough to ground talk of such collectivities as entities that are psychologically autonomous and that, and here he takes the extreme step, and that constitute institutional persons. All of this, I want to suggest, can be a place, I think there are many, this is a place where the arts can serve philosophy quite in a quite dramatic and memorable way, because it's not the case that philosophy of art and so on should put itself in a position of being prescriptive or sort of instructing the arts about what they can and cannot claim and so on. It's as though in philosophy, some people would suggest that if we work out, say, the concept of expression or the concept of the definition of art or the concept of representation and so on, we work that out in advance, independent of any examples, and then the examples are selected only to serve that general claim. What I want to suggest is interesting work in aesthetics, kind of going on today, given the abstracts of the talks to come shortly, is in reverse. And that seems to me to be the right order. Look at the practices first, and then let those practices inform philosophy. But now, how does all this relate to the other theme of today, the philosophical issues, and those issues as they relate to ethics? Well, Wittgenstein said, in the question about how it is we look at and perceive another person, he refers to an attitude towards the soul. And what he suggests there, interesting point, what he suggests is that the attitude we take toward another person is irreducible. It's unlike anything else in perception. And that what it is, in a sense, I want to suggest, is at the heart of ethics. Now, inside an ensemble, inside a cooperative functioning ensemble that is sort of merging into a collective identity, that is, I think, the attitude in play toward each other, and the difference between our walking on a beach and seeing marks in the sand made by nature, the ones on the left, or walking along and seeing human language. And suddenly you say, oh, it's completely different. Or, if you're stranded on a beach somewhere and you don't know where you are, you don't know if there are other human beings there, right? This makes a huge difference. Now, why? Well, think about the phenomenological difference between seeing the former and seeing the latter, right? You would say, well, you can't get to the latter from the former. That's right. You can't get to the perception of a person, right, from the perception of a physical, a mere real thing, Danto's phrase. You can't get to the perception of a person, right, by starting with your perception of a material inanimate object and then adding some stuff. It's not of that kind. Wittgenstein is saying it is actually completely different, right? And that seems to me right. Well, so my suggestion, in closing for today, my suggestion is actually fairly straightforward then. With interactive digital technology, where it is, as a kind of co-improviser, right, we've seen beautiful examples here, it might be time to take two conceptual steps forward. These issues will be discussed later today. One would be to direct Wittgenstein's distinctive attitude toward a soul not only to art, to autonomous individuals, but also to emergent collective entities. So in that case, you say, well, the special psychology you have to actually look at and perceive a person, you can now, following Philip Pettit's idea, you can now look at a collective and in a sense activate the same psychology toward it. And then secondly, having done that, include technological voices, or quote, voices, as full constituent members of the ensemble that together create that collective identity. There's the step, and that's the connection to the contemporary state we're in terms of technology. And that would be then where, in fact, the ethical issue comes in, where we, in a sense, allow into our perceptual world, the phenomenological world of perceiving animate or creative entities, right? We shift that to include co-improvising technologies. Now, if that seems too much, then we could conjoin Wittgenstein's attitude with his remarks on seeing as. There's a long story there, but his discussions of seeing as are really about this. Take the example of a triangle. You can see a triangle in a geometry lecture. You can see it as a drawing of the Pope's headgear. You can see it itself as having fallen over on its side. These are imaginative ways of seeing a given thing. Well, you could add seeing as to Wittgenstein's. If the Philip Pettit step forward is too much, seems too much, like they're not human beings, right? Okay, fine, I agree. But in fact, if that seems too much, then step back and say, well, okay, fine, but then use Wittgenstein's seeing as remarks in connection with his idea about having an attitude toward a soul, and you start to get at a changed way of seeing. So we would then shift our psychological stance toward, and the psychology of our interaction with, interactive technology, we'd change it to a place farther from farther from our response to Marx in Sand and closer to our response to human language in the Sand. Notice that Wittgenstein, on the bottom of page 5, Wittgenstein says in Philosophical Investigations, Part 2, Section 11, he says, the expression of a change of aspect is an expression of a new perception, and at the same time, an expression of an unchanged perception. Now you say, wait, that's a clear contradiction. He's saying P and not P, right? He's saying the expression of a change of aspect, of seeing as, is an expression of a new perception, and at the same time, an expression of an unchanged perception? What is that? That's to see the triangle and see the triangle as also the Pope's hat, right? That's to see something for what it is, but also see it as something else simultaneously. It's to see a co-improvising technology as what it is, but also as a constituent member of an ensemble that is merging into a collective identity where it is then given its due. And so I want to say that in all of this, then, performance practices are, in a sense, driving the philosophy and not as philosophy of art has often proceeded, as I said before, the other way around. I think that would be a positive way forward for philosophical aesthetics. But lastly, I don't want to be misunderstood. By the way, I chose this person's the example of this person's work before I had any idea that he would be sitting in the audience right back here. But George Lewis's work actually is the kind of work that I'm talking about, where, in fact, if you take this picture and the fire department comes rushing up and says, quick, how many people are in that room? You say, one, right? But if you ask how many contributing members to a creative ensemble are in that room, the answer is more complicated, it's more interestingly difficult to answer. And we need a language, I think, to describe that difficulty. That's what I think the plural subject language can help us with. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Do we have questions?
Thank you, Gary, for the beautiful talk, the beautiful music you play. I am working in the computer science side of things and artificial intelligence. And I can see that the algorithms are becoming more and more complex and rich, and now there's the machine learning phenomenon entering into the scene, which make the machine more and more interesting and generative. They propose, they make proposals, generative proposals. And as you know, some people are beginning to speak about machine or computational creativity. I have myself used this phrase a lot of time.
Oh yeah.
Of course, it's a problematic phrase, because how can you speak about the creativity of something that behaves like a subject, but which is not a subject in the philosophical and the psychoanalytical and the psychological sense.
Exactly.
It's a real problem.
Exactly.
Real problem. So, but I was still using it because I could get grants using this. But I was conscious. But I was conscious of the problem. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then, I'm working with Mark, who is here, Mark Chemilian, who are designing, and George, I don't know if George is here, but we're designing software. And we're moving more and more toward something which, in my opinion, is more meaningful, which is the question of co-creativity between agents.
Yeah.
These agents being human and or artificial.
Yeah.
And it, as you said, I'm just saying what you said, repeating what you said, because it's very inspiring. It's a totally different question. Because what happened in this case is that you have a cross-learning phenomenon with all the agents.
Yeah.
Involving complex cross-feedback loops, which makes the resulting phenomenon a complex system in the sense of dynamic complex system, which means that the result is more and different from the sum of the individual behaviors. You cannot explain the result only by explaining and summing the individual behaviors. It's a totally different story.
Exactly. A totally different story, and so we need a totally different language. That's exactly what I'm trying to get. Sorry.
I'm just repeating.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but no, I'm just hastening to agree. That's exactly what I'm trying to get at. What I would like to be able to do is find a language that helps us address the complexity of that situation.
Absolutely.
Right? Because that's presenting to philosophical aesthetics an issue. Right? What are you going to say about this? How are you going to describe it? And how are you going to describe it with the acuity that it deserves? Right, and you know, people often use for example, the word magic is often used in terms of really, really high-end ensembles, and like it was magical. I say, yeah, that's right. It is, or the interaction, right, between players and you know, technologies and so on. The kind of co-creation is a magical thing. I think that's right. But the word magical, or the invocation of the concept of magic, is a place where the question mark shows up. Like, what do you mean by that, right? How do we explain that?
Absolutely.
I feel like I interrupted you.
No. As I said, I'm just repeating what you said, but with the language coming more from the computer side, of course, because I'm not a philosopher. And the interesting thing is that when you are at this level, it doesn't really matter anymore to understand if machine can be or cannot be creative, because the question has no interest anymore.
Yeah.
So it's interesting because we get rid of an unsolvable philosophical problem, and we get into a very concrete and technical problem of making things work together and create this emergence situation.
Exactly.
Would you agree with that?
Absolutely, and what I like about that is that sort of it's not a problem anymore, it's an established world of practice. And that's why I say at the end, it might be time for philosophy to take two steps forward and to acknowledge the fact of our kind of interactive creativity. A lot of musicians, a lot of players working in this kind of complementary, interactive, creative way, where this emergent entity comes out with the technology being one constituent member, right? And that's what's so difficult to explain, and it's difficult in a way to make the conceptual step forward because of those intuitions way, way back at the beginning. Because of those intuitions, right? Because of the idea, well, any collective has got to require that there be human individuals making up the collective that, in fact, have intentional content that can be no greater than the sum total of each individual. That foundational intuition is so deep from the social contract there, from back before that, is so deep that, in fact, it's as though the contemporary practices are excavating that presupposition and saying, you have to think again. You have to find a new way, into it.
So yeah. We're Gary approved.
Yeah, as if that meant anything. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. And just a quick question, because it was not a question there, but just an exchange.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was fascinated by what you said at the beginning, that you have to remove the perception in order to get to the intention, with the example of the Andy Warhol.
Yeah.
Stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting. I still have to process this idea for music, because it's difficult for me to apply it for music, and I wanted to ask you, don't you think this is mostly applicable in the case where you are dealing with conceptual art or virtual phenomenon in music, as when you have a virtual harmony, etc.? I don't know.
Absolutely.
Maybe I didn't understand the
You
concept.
Did. You did. Actually, some of you might be smiling. Actually, Gerard, I wrote a paper arguing that actually this particular subtractive method applies only to conceptual art of a certain kind and not to the entire world of art.
Awesome.
We don't. If you look at a Rembrandt self-portrait, you don't say, that looks exactly like a mirror real thing that is not a work of art, right? That question doesn't arise. It only arises here. But the question actually does arise with, for example, back in the early days of, I recall being a music student back in the dawn of time in the 70s, and I took a class in electronic music at that time, and I recall some of my professors actually referring to sounds as noises. And, you know, well, that's a conceptual mistake right there. I mean, you know, because you say, well, you know, and sort of the question, well, how do these noises fit? You know, that's the wrong concept from day one. But that is like Danto's question. It's like, what's the difference between a mere noise and a sound, right? Well, it's a similar distinction here. So there is a place where that kind of subtractive question applies. But I couldn't agree more that actually the general theory applies to conceptual.
That would apply to Marcel Duchamp's urinal. It is the only way to explain why it is art. Because
classic,
you remove the, okay.
Classic case.
And what remains is.
Exactly right. Yeah. Exactly.
Thank you. Sorry to be so long.
No. It's a pleasure.
I had a hand there that way.
Thank you. That was really, really fascinating. I'm interested in intention, though, because somehow it seems to me that if we think about cognition, intention is inside and outside. You need to have a plane of action, if you like, or a sphere of action in order for you to have an intention. So there's a kind of inside and an outside. So I wonder if you think it's possible for us to share the outside, the plane of intention, if you like, without necessarily having to share the inner intentional bit.
Yeah, interesting question. Yeah, you know, there are, I guess, a couple of ways forward. I've never found the kind of back in the 1960s, I guess, what the kind of, you know, psychological behaviorist reduction of mental life to mere behavior, as though we're nothing but sort of, you know, matter and motion, or nothing but a kind of animal instinctive movement with the epiphenomenal illusion of consciousness and so on. I've never found any of that plausible. For lots of reasons, but in a way you want to preserve the asymmetry between the first person case and the external world, right? So as you're saying, there's that subjective experience and then there's out here, right? But as you're saying, out here is the ground of intentional action. It would be a corrective, I think, to philosophical misconceptions that are too Cartesian, that are too much a matter of internal privacy, to say, look, you can't so much, not only do you need an external ground to enact an intention, you need, here's a stronger claim, I think, that is implicit in your question, you need an external ground to form an intention, right? And there you say, well, wait, then I can't even think of an intention without an external sort of context in which the intention can be formed and manifested, and you say, okay, now we're getting somewhere. I would agree with that entirely, and I say what that does is to function as a kind of corrective against the misconstrual of a human being as, in the first instance, a place of private Cartesian, internally hermetically sealed consciousness, which is only contingently connected to outward things. I don't think it's a, and you don't either, I can tell. You don't think it's a contingent thing at all, right? And so I do think that, you know, music is a great place to study that kind of field of intentional activity. I couldn't agree more. It's out there, you know. But
one last question while the next presenters are getting ready. Thank you.
Okay, Gary, thanks so much. That's amazing. And we've been talking a little bit about our common interests. And I'm going to ask you about you know, the jazz aspect. You know, because this album is Stan Getz with a trio that's a unit. So it's Kenny Barron and Rufus Reed and Victor Lewis.
Exactly.
So these guys have recorded that same year, 1991, a trio album.
Yeah.
So I find that very, very interesting because we players, we do that. Sometimes we jump in to already an ensemble that is there, and it's a unit, and that makes things very, they work.
Yes.
So you get a unit that's there, and they know what's happening. But on the other hand, if you pick musicians individually, then you get different results.
Yeah.
Or if you form a band, like the classic quartet of Train, or Miles was doing, and getting individual people. But I'm interested very much into the different interaction that you get from a unit that will understand things as a trio, you see, and then from individual players. I mean, it's kind of magic, as you said.
Yeah.
And then the last thing is, if you add AI there, if you add, you know, the other element, maybe you have a unit of people that work with those systems, or it's something novel to them.
Yes.
And then you can get different results interacting.
Yeah, those are interestingly different cases. I mean, as you say, you know, the Getz Quartet had been working. They made the two records. The second one was in the can for a couple of years. The label thought, well, maybe we'll put it out. They did. It turned out being, you know, winning all the European Grammys and stuff, you know, hugely, you know, recognized. Album, because they'd been working together for so long, they have this kind of creative merger into this kind of single compositional intelligence inside that collective. But you're quite right. It goes back to what you said yesterday, which I like so much. That is, if you put together an ensemble, you sit in or something, and you quote, as you said, a line from Charlie Parker, instantly everybody knows, okay, you're one of us, in a sense, right?
Yeah, sure.
We can rely on you, and in fact, we can rely on you in a way that is a very sophisticated version of Margaret Gilbert's Walking Together, right? Mm-hmm. We know you're going to be able to walk with us, not just walk alongside, and then we have to kind of adjust to you.
And, the walking together is very interesting because you can walk in exactly by side, that then it's on time.
Yeah.
Somebody walks a little bit ahead, then he's ahead of the time. And then there's the other guy
behind
the time. And then if somebody touches you a little bit, then you have a connection. Or if you say a joke while you're behind the beat or ahead of the beat, or if you look with a certain eye, you know, these are the things that happen. The things that you said that happen instinctively.
Yeah.
You don't explain anything. He's doing something, and the other guys are getting the implication.
You know, exactly that. I hadn't thought of it in that way, but exactly. You know, rushing or dragging. I was playing a gig one night, and I was nervous about it. And the other guitar player leaned over and said, "The way you're playing, you're giving rushing a bad name." and it like stopped. Jumping ahead, we're trying to walk together here. You know, it was exactly that. I hadn't thought about it in that connection, but you're quite right. So I don't want to take a minute more of Clément's time.
Thank you, Gary.
Thanks.
The next talk is about the MICA project, Musical Improvisation and Collective Action. It's presented by two IRCAM researchers from France, Dr. Clément Canon and Serge Gagné.
Thank you very much. So we're a very small research team at IRCAM, and we're working at the crossroads between philosophy, musicology, and cognitive sciences to explore what we can learn about joint action from the special case of free improvisation. And today we're going to talk about the question of coordination in musical improvisation, and more specifically on how to end an improvisation. It seems that this question is getting a lot of attention these days, so Cool. We'll have a nice discussion afterwards. So I'll give the floor to Pierre for introduce the theoretical frameworks, and then I will come back to you with some experimental results.
So the starting point of this research is a distinction that is found in the psychological literature on coordination, which is a distinction between planned coordination and emergent coordination. So in planned coordination, agent's behavior is driven by representations that specify the desired outcomes of joint action and the agent's own part in achieving these outcomes. And you have other sorts of coordination where coordination is emergent. And in this literature, it's approached with the idea that in such cases, coordinated behavior occurs due to perception-action couplings that make multiple individuals act in similar ways, independently of any joint plan or common knowledge. The problem is that if we look at the phenomenon of collective free improvisation, it doesn't fit any of those categories as approached in this literature. It's easy to see that it won't fit the planned coordination case, because in free improvisation, we don't have a referent in the sense of pressing. That is, we don't have a pattern, a pre-existing pattern that will guide the piece. Usually... What did you do?
I thought you were there. Okay. Okay. No. Sorry.
That's good. Sorry. Okay. That's emergent coordination.
Not a successful one.
Okay. So, of course, improvisation won't fit into the plan coordination category because it's non-referent-based and because it's non-idiomatic. But it doesn't either fit, and that's more important here, the emergent coordination category as described by psychologists, because if you look at the definition we gave earlier, it focuses on very low-level process of coordination for very similar actions. And of course, in collective free improvisation, people don't just imitate each other. They are creative. So CFI is a very interesting case for studying coordination. And so why is CFI interesting? First, it displays a high level of complexity that is, in some cases, similar to the complexity you find in scripted musical performances, and something that has been shown by Clément in one of his papers. And also, we have ethnographic data that we get by discussing with improvisers that suggests that these interactions involve very high-level mentalizing, where people actually explicitly ascribe intentional states to improviser. So here's a quote from Louis Laurent, who's an improviser in the Paris scene, who says, "What I like in improvisation is when I can clearly understand the intentions of the others and play with this." And this is something which is very different from just adjusting by perception-action couplings with what other people do. So CFI is a complex case, and the story usually told about emergent coordination doesn't work here. So we need a different story. And so here's a theoretical hypothesis we've been thinking about, which is original in a way, although it draws on some elements taken from other parts of the literature. So the idea is that you can have a sort of coordination that occurs with a succession of local short-term goals that emerge over time and that are updated over time. So those goals are mental representations that are usually used to account for planned coordination and have a specific structure, which is a me plus x structure, which means that you have a goal which involves a collectivity that can be reached by having my own contribution and that involves the contribution of another. And we'll see a clear example later with endings. So it's something that I cannot do by myself, so I need to think of me as doing something and someone else as completing my action. The action of the someone else doesn't have to be fully specified. It can be just an open slot for something else has to be done. And those representations can guide the joint action over time. And what we claim here, or what we propose at least, is that those me plus x representations are efficient over a short action, and then those goals can be updated, changed, revised over time in a successive way. And if you buy this idea, then you can account for emergent coordination over time in this case, when agents form compatible goals over time. and they update them compatibly. So that's a new theoretical framework to think about emergent coordination. And we have actually indirect evidence in favor of this in the case of collective free improvisation. So one kind of evidence comes from the EMIC categories of improvised action. So EMIC categories are the concepts that agents use to make sense of their own practice. And so if you have people make improvisations and then collect first-order reports of what they thought they were doing when they were improvising, they talk about making decisions, they talk about short-term goals in a particular situation. So for example, in this particular situation, I wanted to maintain the ongoing music, I wanted to densify it. In some other cases, they would say, well, we were getting bored with this particular sequence, so we wanted to move to something different. This is thing that people say, and it's not too difficult to make a classification of those kinds of goals. And this has been done in several papers. So Clément has done that in a joint paper with Nicolas Gardier as early as 2012. You have another paper from Wilson and McDonald that gives like a systematic picture of this kind of stuff. So this means that there's a ethnographic phenomenological reality to this idea that people form like goals over time. And also there's a second piece of evidence that comes from segmentation studies. So the idea is that if you look at the kind of form that collective free improvisation pieces take, usually they can be divided into clear segments that have a sort of transitory identity. And so you enter a sequence, and then something solidifies, and then people want to change and move to a different section. So this is something we find in the few analyses of free improvisation pieces that you find in the musicological literature. And also you can also try to have people signal when they turn to a new segment, for example, by using pedals. And this is something that Clément has done in a study in 2015 with Nicolas Garnier. So we have indirect evidence that this is not totally imaginary, this model. But the thing is that we'd like to get more direct evidence in favor of this. And in order to do that, I think we need to show two things. One would be to show that coordination in CFI actually does rely on the online formation and updating of local goals. So we need to show that those goals are there and that they are operative in some way. And also, we need to show that the formation and updating of those local goals actually facilitates the coordination in CFI. So that are two new challenges in order to provide more direct evidence in favor of this hypothesis. And this is what you did with the special case of endings.
Yeah, so we thought that endings were especially a good case study to test the hypothesis Pierre just introduced. Because first, every improvisation has to end, so this coordination problem has to be faced somehow, of when and how to end has to be faced in every improvisation ever. Also, endings are a good case of a me plus X goal. You can't end an improvisation by yourself. If the other improvisers are still playing, this is not the end, so you need the others to end with you. And third, coordination success in endings can be operationalized through different metrics that are both quantitative and qualitative. So we can measure the synchronization at the ends between the different players. So that will be quantitative measures of coordination. And we can also collect aesthetic evaluations and descriptions of the ending, both from the first person, from the musicians themselves, and from third-party listeners, from the audience, for example. So we can have very rich data, both qualitative and quantitative, to assess the success of coordination in ending. So that makes it a very good case study to test this hypothesis of local goals. So the first experiment we did is that we gathered 12 trios in a professional recording studio in Paris. Each trio was asked to perform four improvisations of roughly 4 minutes. Each musician was in a separated studio booth, so they couldn't see each other, but in a studio, they of course heard each other through headphones. Why we did that? Because each musician had a foot pedal, and we asked the musician to press the pedal when you feel that you're looking for an ending to the improvisation. That was important that the musician didn't see each other, otherwise they would just see if the other had pressed his pedal. They could influence his or her own evaluation. So here is just a small video of what the setting looked like. Thank you. if you're interested, we have 191 more of those if you need some video to show to you. People. So first question, do shared goals emerge during the course of the improvisation? So yes, local goals do emerge. We observe in 90% of the performances, so almost each one of them, that at least one musician had looked for an ending at some point. And more importantly, shared goals also emerge in 50%, so roughly half of the performances. Which means that at least in half of the performances, at least two musicians had pressed on their foot pedals roughly at the same time. Okay. Now, do these shared goals impact the coordination? So to test that, we need a much more controlled experiment than what we did with the pedal, which was very observational. So that's what we did a second experiment with the same setup. So we gathered 12 trios. They were each asked to play 12 improvisations, again in a studio, again for roughly 4 minutes. But this time, the experimental manipulation was the following. Musicians would receive a secret prompt through their headphones. So sometimes they heard the prompt "me," and then their goal was to find a good ending point for themselves. Okay. But sometimes they heard the keyword "we," and then their goal was to find a good ending point for the group, for the whole improvisation. And sometimes, of course, they were not prompted, so they didn't hear nothing at all. Crucially, we also manipulated the number of musicians receiving the prompt. So either one musician, two musicians, or the whole group, that is three musicians. So when several musicians received the prompt, they received it at the same time. And lastly, after each improvisation, each musician was asked to guess what were the goals of her fellow co-improvisers and to rate the ending of the performance on a 7-point Likert scale. So the main result of this experiment is that shared we goals improve the synchronization. So the more the goal to find a good ending point for the group is shared within the group, the more the musicians will be synchronized at the end. But what is important is, what is crucial, is that concurrent me goals, so when musicians were looking for a good ending point for themselves, concurrent me goals do not facilitate synchronization as much, and in some cases, it even impaired the synchronization, as you can see in this graph. So the important point here is that it's not any collection of individual goals that is enough to improve synchronization. It's not enough that musicians all individually want to find a good ending point for themselves. What really matters, what is really important, is that improvisers share goals that involve the group as a whole, or the collective outcome of the performance as a whole. That's what really makes an important difference here. Here is another result from this experiment. So in this graph, you can see the time interval between the moment the musician receives the prompt and the actual ending of the improvisation. So what you can see is that so what you can see is that for the end to happen, the goal needs to be shared within the group. If only one musician is trying to find an ending for the group, it just takes forever. It just takes 80 seconds in average. But as soon as two musicians have the goal to find an ending for the piece, it actually happens very very quickly. So we have shown with this experiment that shared we goals improve synchronization and shared we goals improve goal achievement. So they're quicker to actually reach an end. But do they also improve the aesthetic quality of endings? So not according to the improvisers. We didn't see any significant correlations between the aesthetic evaluation of endings and or different conditions. But many things could explain this lack of result. First, each improviser only had a partial perspective on the performance, and so potentially lacks the global picture that could be perceived by external listeners. Second, it's also well known from the literature, but also from testimonies by musicians and improvisers, that collective improvisation is full of dissensus, and that such dissensus among the musicians does not necessarily translate into an unsuccessful improvisation. And third, some of the musicians were simply uncomfortable with writing the ending and telling us it's up to the audience to decide if it was or not a good ending. So that's what we did. We did a third experiment when we asked 41 listeners, so among them 16 expert improvisers, just to listen to the end of all these improvisations we have recorded. So they listened to the last 50 seconds. And we asked them, was it a good ending? Again, on a 7-point Likert scale. And also, we asked them if they thought that the end was collective or disjoint, hierarchical or egalitarian, progressive or immediate, predictable or surprising, early, late or timely. And here is just one example. So the main result here is that listeners actually liked significantly more the endings where the goal to find a good stopping point for the group was actually shared by all three improvisers. That's the third bar from the left you can see here. And another interesting result is that they also found that such endings, so the endings where all the members in the group actually were looking for a group ending, were much more timely, so neither too soon or too late than in all other conditions. So we seem to have a good reason to think that shared we goals, when they emerge, actually improve coordination in the ending, both from a quantitative point of view, so they're more synchronized, and also from a more qualitative point of view, listeners find that the ending was more successful, and for example, that it was more timely. But one very last question now is that how can we explain goal propagation? So how can we explain when one musician is starting to look for an ending, for example, another musician will start also looking for an ending roughly at the same time? So here we have two competing hypotheses to discuss. The first hypothesis is that there is some form of communicative strategies and mind-reading processes that allow for the formation of shared goal representations to emerge. So musicians engage these communicative mind-reading processes, and that's how shared goals emerge, okay. Like in conversation, for example. Another hypothesis, which is much more low-level, is to say that musicians simply track the gestalt of what the other musicians are doing. For example, they track gestalt expressing a descending energy profile. So if one musician will start to do a decrescendo, the others will simply follow her and start doing a decrescendo on their own. So we don't need any mind reading, we don't need any communicative process, it's just we attune each other to the global energy level, and that's it. So we did a last fourth experiment to pit these two hypotheses, one against the other, which was a detection task. So we extracted short snippets of sound from the individual tracks of the corpus I presented earlier. And we asked the listeners to tell us, do you think that the musician is about to stop playing? And also, in your opinion, what the musician was playing was ascending, descending, constant, no direction, repetitive or varied, predictable or surprising, confident or hesitant. So here is just an example of what the listeners actually heard. I forgot to mention that those snippets were selected from ALF just after the musician had received the prompt, so the musician was actually looking for an ending, and for the other ALF before they actually received the prompt, so they were not looking for an ending at all. Sorry. So here's the main result from this experiment is that the snippets Here it is. The snippet in which the musician was looking for an ending for the group were described as more predictable and more repetitive, but not significantly as more descending, which is the important result. We also ran some acoustical analysis, and it's not significant at all that when musicians were looking for an end for the group, that they were doing more decrescendos. It's not significant at all. So basically, there are many ways to perform an end, to do an end for an improvisation. It's not just doing a decrescendo. It's not simple as that, of course. So this acoustical analysis and those qualitative annotations from external listeners of just solo snippets, so you don't have any contextual cues, you don't have what the others are doing, you just have the information from the musician herself. And even with that, who could tell, okay, she's looking for an ending or not, okay? So that could be an indication that musicians looking for an ending actually engage in more abstract signaling strategies and not just perform a simple gestalt, for example, doing a decrescendo. But of course, we have much more work to do with this experiment. So in particular, we need to isolate which musical and acoustic features are used by the listeners in order to detect an ending goal. And we also need to identify the kind of underlying mechanisms that are at play in goal detection on the basis of those features. So in conclusion, shared local goals can emerge in improvised interactions. That was the first experiment. Shared local goals impact coordination. They improve synchronization. That was the second experiment. And they improve aesthetic evaluations. That was the third experiment. And they propagate via signaling or commutative strategies. That was the fourth experiment. More generally, these experiments provide direct evidence in favor of the local goal hypothesis as a valid theoretical framework for improvised joint action in general. And thanks to Louise Goupil and Thomas Wolf who work with us on this whole project. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have questions? Come on, come on.
Hey, thank you for the research. Being a free improviser myself, I have one question. Did you ask from the people who were playing, why were they looking for the end? Because my own experience says to me that there are basically three options why people are looking for the end. One is that they are tired, they want to finish it, it has been already 1 hour. Another one is that there is one person who is kind of end killer, and this is not cool. Yeah, and I forgot the third option.
One.
And yeah, the third option is the one which is cool, which means that there is a kind of collective agency from the previous lecture, and the music just wants to end, yeah. And it's finished. So, yeah.
Yeah, very nice question. We didn't ask why they were looking for an end, because we assumed that all these reasons were valid ones. But we asked them at the end of each session, do you think the other improvisers were looking for an end at some point? And if so, why? And so we also collected really interesting, so there are qualitative data, descriptions, but really nice, really interesting, and really rich, because we have 600 of those descriptions, so we can start to do some interesting stuff of what it is that do you track, or what do you think when, how do you know that someone in the group, for example, is looking for an end? So we have some information which are compatible with what we explained. So how he was sending some signals. So remember that they didn't have any visual cues, so it was just through the headphones. So okay, we had some signals in the music itself. Sometimes it was the gestalt. Sometimes it's like, you can feel that she is tired. So that's one of the answers we got. She has enough. We just need to stop. Okay, but yeah, we did not have any more information on why they are looking for an end.
Okay, and one very small question more. Were the players from different countries?
So no, they were not from different countries. No, they were all from the Parisian improvised scene. But we have a lot of variability in how familiar they were with each other. So in some of the trio, they were well, they know each other very well, and they were used to play together. Some of the trios were just ad hoc settings. That was the first time they played together, and I didn't show there, but we have some really nice effects of familiarity in one, the emergence of shared goals. So the more musicians know each other, the more local goals will emerge at the same time. That makes sense, right? And we have other cool aspects of familiarity also like that. So we were able to control for that. But they were from the, maybe your question, they were from roughly the same aesthetic background. I mean, it's also true. Some were more jazz-oriented, some were more into like contemporary-like free improvisation. So there was some variety also on an aesthetic level. But it's difficult to control and to have some real conclusions based on this.
Yeah, I think this experiment could last longer if there is more different backgrounds and also different ethnical backgrounds, because I have a feeling that it somehow is also related with the person's own background, yeah. And where does it come and what is the folk music, for example, in the countries.
So. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's very culture dependent, context dependent. Also, remember that we asked them to improvise for 4 minutes. So they had this rough guidelines. Somehow it was like a script overall. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Another question?
Thank you so much. First, I want to say you saved me from doing so much work. I feel like I should transfer grant money to you, you know. So it's great that the experiments have gone this far. I'm sort of interested in your early slides of your sort of cognitive model, which you parsed in terms of a duo, right?
Oh, yeah.
And my first thought was, and I suspect maybe you haven't directed your attention towards this yet, but that sounds like the cognitive CPU really heavy model, particularly if you move it beyond two. So you have me and X, me and Y, me and Z, me and X and Y, me and X and Z, me and X and Y and Z. And that made me think of this model with regards to sort of Gary's, because it looks like the sort of indirect evidence you gave, take segmentation, that seems equally suggestive of this, or a sort of emergent singularity, yeah. Single subjectivity. So I'm wondering if you have any longer term thoughts about how to relate your really interesting experimental results to the kind of cognitive model here that you've been advocating or is suggestive of what you've been doing.
So there are several things in your question. So the first thing is about the case where N is much superior than two. And I didn't have time to present all the details, but the X part does not necessarily mean one agent, and it doesn't imply that it requires a fine-grained description of an agent. So the idea is that I'm playing in a very large ensemble, and actually we have also a study with the Ensemble, who is an improvised ensemble. They improvise freely with 30 people at the same time. So we recorded them, and we are running also a study with this. In this particular case, X would be all the others. So you don't. So of course there is a worry that this model could be really too much, but there is a lightweight reading of it, which is I need just to represent a goal for the whole group, and I have a way to contribute to that end, and it requires that someone else does something. So it's not just about me. So this is the way you capture collective intentionality in a way.
So X is just not me.
Yeah, I mean,
we did something else than me.
It's supposed to be a collective. So, but it's tautological. It's an open empirical hypothesis. And so this has been tested by psychologists with studies of co-representation. So do I need to represent only my own task? Do I need to represent something else? Does it have to be explicit or not? So this is an empirical hypothesis, just not tautological.
Run for it. house tonight. It looks really nice on camera.
Impressive.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. I was wondering, and relates to the first question, in my experience also as an improviser, time is a big factor. So I was wondering how much the 4 minute constraint, because there is an hierarchy of time in there. So you have the 4 minute constraint, and then you have the cue, the prompt. So within that 4 minutes, they also have to make other decisions in terms of finishing. And I think in my experience as a free improviser, unless you agree beforehand, say like, let's play a set, which then is 45 minutes, 50 an hour. Normally around 15 minutes is a kind of limit that you reach and you think like, okay, it's time to, you know, everyone gets tired and it's time to find an ending. So that 4 minute, I was wondering if you had time to look into it and how it affected the decisions of the others, of the players. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a really good question, and it's true that it did constrain a lot the interaction and the pre-planification and everything. But we thought, like from also previous studies, like this 3, 4, 5 minutes is like a typical duration of. So maybe we need to extend data on this. But like it's typical duration of a sequence. In a wall set, for example. So we thought that it will be a good duration for, like a good natural duration to go to the end of, let's say, the first ID or the first sequence. But then, even if you constrain this overall duration, there are still many, many places, many, many opportunities when you can actually end. Because it was not presented also as a script that you have to play 4 minutes and that's your goal. It was, okay, let's play. So you have this rough idea of a duration, but then, I mean, the good ending point can be at 3 minutes, and it's perfectly fine, you know. So we make sure to tell them that it was really more regulative than normative. You know, it was not a rule they had to follow. It was just to give them an idea so they don't play 25 minutes. So we just want to avoid it, that.
And I think that margin. I mean, this is a very important issue, especially in order to connect what they did in this experiment to the real world, because this like. Time setting was like imposed in a way. But one way to think about it is that depending on the familiarity of the improvisers you play with, there is some kind of contextual default, which is contextual. So if you're playing a gig, you're expected to play, say, an hour, and you're free to divide it into like one set, two sets, or. And this will constrain the kind of expectation you can make, and those will be different if you're just like rehearsing or doing just a free session in some place without any audience, and then you can play as much as you want. And if you want to stop after 5 minutes, you can, and if you want to stop after 2 hours, you can. So I think the idea of a default that is like divisible over time is one way to think about it.
Okay, let's thank Clément and Pierre one more time. Thank you. The last talk before the coffee break is on machine ethics and music creativity by researcher Dr. George Costeletos and associate professor Dr. Anastasia Georgaki, both from the University of Athens.
Yes, I would like to say that after this very nice journey into improvisation technologies during 3 days, we have seen many concerts and speeches and many workshops, so I feel richer and I can ask where are we going? And many times I ask about that, and as I am a musicologist and a musician in music technology, I have collaborated the last years with a philosopher and researcher in cognitive science, George Costeletos, and we have written three papers almost, about music technology ethics. Because we have seen that there is no many references in this domain, and we try to find out how we have passed from music ethics to music technology ethics, and how our society is changing by new technologies. So I will just make a small introduction, because the most of the lecture will be George Costeletos, who has a double background in philosophy of the mind and neuroscience, and for the moment he's researcher at the Laboratory of Psychophysiology at the first psychiatric clinic School of Medicine. And he's also a postdoctoral researcher in applied philosophy at the University of Athens. So he's doing a lot of experiments on the moral values of music. So he's going to tell us what's going on in this domain. But me, just I'm going to make a small introduction about the fifth revolution that we are going to live in some years. Here in Greece, it comes slowly, slowly, but I think that the people that live in the States are inside that. And we are going to, I'm going just to present very briefly, when we speak about music creativity from the machines, there are five, at least four or five sectors that we could speak about. And the first is the music composition system. When we have seen the first book from David Cope, Experiments on Artificial Intelligence, and today we have so many composers that they are doing real-time composition, and Georg has done yesterday, has shown us what he is doing with his algorithms, and he is connecting composition with performance and improvisation through real-time interactive systems. After, there is the aspect that Gerard is going through. It's improvisation with the performer in real time, and there are a lot of questions, but also it's a very interesting research domain, and we have the domain of the performance. After, we have, as George Sanetakis said, the music robots, which are here, and Jill Weinberg with his Simone, and he said about the embodiment and the need of the musician to see the robot acting, so he needs a physical presence. And of course, we neglect the big music industry and machine learning, and there I will just show you some photos about that. For example, will robots top the chart? This is a question, and this is the domain that we don't know so well, us that were from musicological departments, that AI is being applied in this domain. So just to start, here we have an old way music ethos in ancient Greece. It also started from Plato, Damon, etc., etc., the notion of music ethos. And here just an oracle. What is the Oracle of Delphi? The Tetractys, the harmony of the Syrian sync. So there maybe we have some automata. I don't speak about that now, but there are many references about automatic music in ancient Greece. And as now we have the Laboratory of Ancient Music Instruments, maybe AI will help us to solve some problems. And I would like just to pass from Middle Ages and Renaissance and say that AI is going to connect trivium and quadrivium in the future, because we see that we have many references why music is connected to mathematics from the quadrivium, but we see that now we have all these rules of logic, grammar, and rhetoric, speaking, prosody or whatever, through the AI systems. Here you see the AI music robots from director of the orchestra till the marimba player that are already in action in the States. And of course, Google, that the last years is presenting all these doodles about music and AI. And of course, we have another domain, that's the revival of stars. And you see Maria Callas on the scene, and you can interact with her. So there are many domains of music creativity that we don't know so well. Of course, I will speak just a little about the algorithmic aspects, that the symbolic creative machines, evolutionary algorithms, and generative deep learning neural networks that are for our researchers to say in which way we can improvise or create new music through all these algorithms. And for the composer, that Georg said that I don't know what is improvisation, I am a composer. So many composers now use AI, and of course they want to use a performer to have a body presence on the scene, who after with his gestures or with his body, he's going to transform the music. But by the demands of the composer. And of course, the machine. With the machine, we have many interfaces. And I come to our subject, that is machine improvisation. I would like to say that at machine improvisation, we have computer-driven improvisation by a composer, but we have also computer-aided improvisation for understanding different styles. Xavier Serrat has spoken about that, in which way we can develop AI for understanding idiomatical improvisation and interacting. And Emilios Kaburopoulos has spoken about AI for blending idiomatic improvisations through computational models in different styles. So there are many things that we must take in account and see in which way we can use computer music-aided improvisation in order to understand different styles in ethnomusicology or in jazz. After Gerard, with computer-generated improvisation by interacting with a performer, we have the music robots improvisation and many improvisation technologies for participatory performance, which is another cue that connects the performer, the composer, with the audience. And now they are in act. We have people, for example, that worked in Stanford, and they are doing the choral, the chorus, with the audience, with improvisation technologies, Telemachos Mousas and Teli Papakostadinou. And just to finish, and because after Yorgos will start his presentation, I have some ethical questions about machine improvisation and the social intelligence. I don't speak at all about composition or about music production or about music industry. I speak especially about the theme of our conference, machine improvisation. Improvisation is both personal and social, a practice-based group activity whose lack of coherence between action and dialectics is catastrophic for credibility, but vital to adaptation. So my questions here, and George is going to answer to some of these questions through the theory of mind, improvisation might have the external appearance of an utopian community or cult where the computer should be the medium for not only a dialogue, but also for dialectics. This is a very difficult question. From the postmodernization of jazz through music industry, Eric Hobsbawm has said that, we're facing, as I said, the fifth revolution, the revolution of AI, a new era of co-creation, as Gerard has said, with the machines. Can co-creativity with the machines bridge the past and the present and articulate an utopian sensibility that suggests that a different world might be, indeed, be possible? Third, can machine improvisation bridge cultural anthropology and ethnomusicology with historical systematic musicology, where we can explore the limits of improvisation in music, learn which are the archetypal patterns of performer in East and West culture, and interact with music that are improvised? Fourth, can machine improvisation be seen as a laboratory of social experimentation of a non-hierarchical organization which offers a dialogic conversation of unvoiced thoughts and actions, often unresolved or disrupted? Can machine improvisation go through this communication? Fifth, could machine improvisation articulate collectivism, a sounding out of group listening and responding? Can we examine the ethos with the principles of this communication embodied by the musician vs. the machine? And the last one that George will go through is, do creative machines tread on intellectual ground that was once considered the sole domain of the human mind, and before that, the product of divine inspiration? These are my questions, and so I invite George Costeletos to continue.
Full screen. Okay.
So Professor Hagberg earlier this morning referred to intentions. And a very popular question in AI ethics is how one can evaluate the existence of intentions in mechanic entities. Of course, there's a second question. What is the point of the first question? So we will hopefully look through these questions through the forthcoming presentation part. Robots producing sound output that could be characterized as musical trigger the researchers' interest in two ways. They stress the need for a discussion with regards to the attribution of authorship rights to a machine. And second, they feed the idea of a musical Turing test, thus the idea for music creation as a valid criterion of intelligence. In the following part of our presentation, we will examine whether machine musical creativity, and especially machine musical improvisation, can provide us with answers regarding the issue of machine authorship and generally the issues arising from a robot-centric view of roboethics. Now, usually all roboethical questions are tackled within a human-centric perspective, namely the filter of human interests and rights. However, they could be also approached through a robot-centric perspective. This would cast a totally new light on roboethics issues. It would also bring forth a new set of questions like, should we attribute a moral status to robots? Or in other words, should we recognize robot rights and obligations? And if yes, which rights and which obligations? The possibility of creative robots brings forth the right to the artistic authorship. In its turn, this right is interconnected with a set of other rights and questions like copyright issues, one's right to be appreciated for one's own work, as well as questions regarding the ontology of the mechanic output. All these questions are actually an issue of inviting and finally including robots and computing systems in general in our moral taxonomy. So how is this taxonomy organized and what could define the place of robots in it? Some of the most pressing questions in roboethics regarding the robots are the same with questions regarding humans, for instance, refugees or immigrants. The safety question, the antagonism question, the cultural diversity question, the suppression question, and of course the moral status question. Should they be entitled to a full moral status, full moral rights and obligations? Should we allow them to be equal partners of ours? And this is also the collective part of the whole discussion. The last one is also a fundamental question of socio-robotics. So, however, compared to the case of humans like immigrants and refugees, one has to face, in the case of robots, some additional and very painful set of questions. Are robots intelligent? Are they conscious? Are they self-aware? Are they sentient? These are qualities that we have a priori attributed to every human being, but how about the robots? So robots could be thought of as the ultimate others. Now, in the past, of course, not all humans found an easy way to our moral taxonomy, and not all of them were positioned at its top right away. The moral taxonomy was always affected by cultural norms and was not based on objective criteria. It was fabricated in a rather arbitrary way. So efforts to disguise cultural norms with scientific flavor have also occurred, for instance, the case of phrenology. And there's a question. Is there nowadays moral taxonomy free of such parasitic factors? Is it based purely on objective data? And which data would be of relevance? So let us have a brief look at our moral taxonomy as it is formulated by continuous bioethical analysis, but also by our everyday life moral rules of thumb. And this taxonomy is mainly based on notions like intelligence, consciousness, and sentience. And humans, of course, are at the top of it, with adults having a full-fledged set of obligations and rights. And in lower positions, we have animals and plants. The basic feature for entering our moral taxonomy in the case of animals and plants is sentience. But in the case of robots, we are in a rather blurred grounds right now. Robotics and AI ethics disagree about robots, about the moral status of robots, and there are many official positions opposing each other. So animals and plants were quite recent applicants for entering our moral taxonomy, and they fought their way in, and they are still doing. So plants could be accepted in our moral taxonomy if we attribute to them a low level of sentience and a minimized sense of consciousness to the aspect of reacting to environmental change and adapting autonomously. But isn't this possible for robots too? And there are two frequent objections to this question. The fact that robots are artificial, mechanic, and they're not living beings, and the fact that robots are programmed. So let us look closely at these two objections. The first one is called the organic view, namely the view that an entity that doesn't consist of organic matter can be intelligent. Now, we can reply to this objection from an argument from the theory of mind field, multiple realizability argument, according to which any given mental state could be implemented by multiple different physical states. And there's no logical experimental restriction for the physical realization of a mental state. This is actually a consequence of the mind-body problem. We've been having all these great descriptions of the physical part of ours with brain states, with central nervous system states, and we have all the psychological description of ours with mental states, intentions, beliefs, emotions, and so on. But we haven't managed to link these two together. We haven't managed to translate the one to the other. So there's an explanatory gap, as we say in the field of philosophy of mind, and as long this gap exists, all physical to mental realization possibilities are left open. Also, the organic view faces some other problems, like the mixed entities problems, like in case of cyborgs, they have some non-biological parts. So should they have a less privileged place in our model taxonomy? And with regards to the other objection of the program nature of computers, humans could be also thought of as being programmed. Turing was first that noticed that nothing is the parthenogenesis, everything starts with some form of education, training by the environment. And you have in modern neuroscience many experimental findings about pre-attentive mechanisms, automatic mechanisms, in which our environment is imprinted in us. And this is also in agreement with anthropological work by Pierre Bourdieu and other philosophers, and other anthropologists, sorry. So under these views, the environment could be thought of as being a programmer, and humans could be thought of as being programmed too. So there's more metaphysical fuzziness, for instance, a purely mechanistic and materialistic view of the human being. Under this view, not even humans can stand out from plants. And this is what Offre de Lamartine once said, the first, probably one of the first materialist philosophers. Nowadays, Peter Singer, a very famous bioethicist, has treated sentience as the ultimate criterion of attribution of moral rights to any being and to human or non-human beings. However, other nowadays philosophers, like eliminative materialists, deny the existence of mental states, thus sentience, even in humans. So how would such a denial affect our moral taxonomy? Wouldn't such a view eliminate the whole of ethics? Would that this view equate humans to machines? And how about people with genital analgesia or anhedonia, people who cannot feel pain or people who cannot feel pleasure? Do they have less sentience than us? Does this reduce their self-awareness too? Are they less humans? So the definition of a human being that we had in mind when we created this moral taxonomy seems very narrow, so narrow that very few of us might meet its criteria. Now, the project of establishing a consistent moral taxonomy is transformed to a process of creating an ontological taxonomy of the possible moral agents. But not only do researchers disagree about the ontological validity of notions like sentience or consciousness, they also provide us with a plethora of different definitions. So if the organic view is problematic and if we can't have access to other beings' mental states, what's left for us as a medium for the construction of a solid intelligence criterion? And the answer is behavior, observation of behavior. Descartes was one of the first philosophers who discussed about these behavioral criteria, and Alan Turing, during the 20th century, discusses the possibility of an imitation game as intelligence criterion of effective language communication. This was later called the Turing test. Now, according to the Turing test, we have two groups of participants. We have the judges, who are all humans, and we have the participants, the players. Some of them are humans, some of them are machines. They are placed in completely separated rooms. There isn't any possibility of visual or oral communication between the judges and the players. And the judges try to understand which player is a machine and which is a human through written messages, for instance, through a computer terminal communication. Now, the theory says that if a machine manages to fool a judge, then it should be thought of as being intelligent. Now, please bear in mind that, according to some researchers, Turing's true intentions behind all this was not to provide us with a solid behavioral criterion, but rather start up a conversation about the arbitrariness of our intelligence discriminative criteria. However, Turing test became very famous. It's the most analyzed and referenced behavioral test of intelligence nowadays. We have too many descriptions and versions, the Leibniz test, the toy Turing test, the total Turing test, in which we have an evaluation of a holistic interaction with the world, the embodied Turing test, the reverse Turing test, and the CAPTCHA test, which is very known. Now, Turing test and every behavioral criterion comes with expenses. It has problems. The first problem is the subjectivity of the behavioral cues usually employed by the judges in the Turing test. These are superarticulacy and the fame problem. The basic idea is that computers, because of the fact that they run programs, they can come up with really extensive, extended, and detailed descriptions and very delicate and accurate actions. This is called superarticulacy. But on the other hand, again, due to the fact that they run programs, this efficiency is limited only within a frame of possible circumstances foreseen by their program. So this is their frame problem. But the problem with this excuse is that even humans fail with them. Not all humans are adjustable to changes in their environment, so not all humans can overcome the frame problem. Also, there are humans capable of giving extended and detailed explanation, analysis, and descriptions. Under the superacute QLAC measure, they would have failed in a Turing test. And this has actually happened in several contexts. So, the second problem is the subjectivity of the theories of cognition and intelligence. Take, for instance, the embodied cognition theory, according to which the body plays significant causal or physical constitutive roles in cognition. Under this theory, another very thin and strict interpretation of this theory, a system that does not have a body, for instance, a webbot, could never be intelligent. So a priori terms, its participation to a Turing test is useless. On the other hand, if we take the extended mind theory, in which intelligence does not lie inside individuals, but is rather at the level of intercommunication between individuals, the Turing test is useless because this destroys the distinction between a human judge and a machine. They both can be thought of as being one unified intelligent system. And take, for instance, the multiple intelligence theory. According to this theory, a machine that would pass a musical, for instance, version of Turing test would not be thought of as being fully intelligent, since it would have satisfied only one aspect of intelligence. See, it would have to pass a series of other Turing tests having to do with all the other kinds of intelligence. So the Turing test looks like a beam of light passing through a kaleidoscope of theories. Its different theory makes the Turing test project a different outcome. And the third problem is our psychological inclination towards the machine, called the intentional stance, our tendency to attribute mental states and especially attentions to the entities around us. In human-machine interaction, it has been registered as the ELISA effect, and there are also experimental data clarifying the neuroscientific basis of our intentional stance towards the robots. It is related to the activation of our mirror neuron system. This effect has also been observed from childhood, and it's quite possible to affect human judgment in a Turing test context. And this is an also a big problem, the as-if argument, the possibility of a plain imitation. According to this argument, a machine seems to be intelligent. It acts as if it was intelligent. However, imitating intelligent behavior does not prove intelligence on behalf of the imitator. The as-if argument holds as a possibility for the Turing test and any other behavioral criteria. And also, it is fed in a critique against the moral status of social robots. It is fed. Now, this argument goes hand by hand with the Chinese room argument from John Searle, also from the philosophy of mind, according to which a successful syntax does not presuppose, thus does not entail a meaning understanding. So every time we see a machine outputting a very well syntaxed behavior, for instance in music, thus this does not necessarily mean that the machine understands what it's doing. There's a meaning there. The as-if argument brings forth the demand for originality, the idea of an original mechanic action as an indication of true intelligence. Ada Lovelace was probably the first researcher who mentioned this measure, and she writes, while translating a paper on Charles Babbage's analytic paper, "Not before it could produce an original and spontaneous action should a machine like Babbage's analytic engine be thought of as being intelligent." And with originality comes music creativity as she continues. Supposing, for instance, that the fundamental relations of pitch sounds in the science of harmony and musical composition were susceptible of such expression and adaptations, the engine might compose elaborate and scientific pieces of music of any degree of complexity or extent. This idea of artistic creativity as a criterion for intelligence was also brought forth one century later by the famous neurologist Jeffrey Jefferson, and it was also commented and cited by Alan Turing. So the view that art is a higher order aspect of human intelligence dates back to antiquity. It was also an idea cultivated during the Romantic era, and some nowadays researchers have also adopted this view. And they come up with some artistic versions of the Turing test. The literature Turing test, the short game, the poetic Turing test, the painting Turing test, and of course we have some musical versions of it. The musical directive toy test, according to which the participants are asked to compose a musical piece of specific kind, style, or emotional content. The musical output toy test, in which the kind or style of the musical piece is not specified. The stylistic musical output toy test, the discrimination test, and of course the musical total Turing test, which comes with three versions, the robots playing a musical instrument to perform a given musical piece, robots taking up the role of a soloist performing a concerto with an orchestra of human musicians, and three robots improvising solo or in musical dialogue with human musicians. You can call this last version the musical improvisation Turing test. So researchers that have adopted Lovelace's view on originality and spontaneity, they propose that the measure of machine creativity, therefore intelligence, could be the programmer's surprise and inability to explain the output of the machines. The criterion of surprise due to originality seems to be fully satisfied by the idea of a musical improvisation Turing test. Musical improvisation is loose and spontaneous by nature. Therefore, it seems to satisfy the criterion of unprecedented, thus original action. But there are problems with spontaneity and surprise. Program errors also seem to come out of the blue. Programmers do not anticipate them and usually can't easily explain them. Moreover, in certain kinds of programming, it is possible to foresee the final output in every detail. However, in neither of these cases do we literally attribute intelligence to the machines. Additionally, stochastic or chaotic mechanisms are also found in nature without being linked to intelligent entities. Furthermore, spontaneity can be programmed through errors and pseudo-random output, and therefore the machine looks as if it has produced an unexpected, thus original creative behavior. However, also in cases in which the machine outputs a foreseeable outcome, one has to examine also the possibility that the machine has deliberately chosen to follow its program. In this case, the machine seems not to be intelligent while it actually is. Thus, the as-if argument holds for both the cases, either the machine presents a behavior judged as surprising or not. All possibilities are still left open. Finally, Turing and Harpen stress on the fact that the judge's surprise in a Turing test is mostly related to the judge's expectation, and this brings forth the case of artistic relativity. By introducing artistic criterion to the musical versions of the Turing test, we actually inject more relativity to the whole discussion. Since on top of the relativity of notions like intelligence or consciousness or self-awareness, we add the relativity of notions like art and music. And this relativity can be traced in multiple levels. For instance, not all civilizations have the word art in their language. The first ethnomusicologists arrived in Bali realized that the Balinese people did not have the word art or artist in their vocabulary. So they didn't distinguish art from the rest remaining net of activity. So could the Balinese understand or conceive the function of an artistic version of a Turing test or any other artistic version of a behavioral criterion of intelligence? But also within the Western context, cultural context, art has become through numerous redefinitions, especially in the case of conceptual art. Art has invaded reality, as it was proven by the work of numerous artists, and art has been following a course of continuous de-definitions as it cancels out all the previous definitions of it. Arthur Dardo has called this the end of art. So let us imagine what would be the judge's view in a musical output toy Turing test if John Cage himself participated in this with his 4 minutes and 33 seconds piece. Or how about Pierre Seffer's pieces of Musique Concrète, or how about an older composer's Eric Satie's Fixations? Would they pass the Turing test? So, proceeding with the relativity of art, much controversy exists also regarding the psychological substrates of art. And there's this debate between the cognitivists, the emotivists, and those who support the expressional independence and self-referential nature of music. There's a debate of whether music expresses anything and whether it expresses emotion or whether it can also induce emotion to the listeners. So, what in the context of a musical improvisation Turing test, the machine plays some phrases in a manner that looks very passionate? Would it be thought of as a genuine expression of music, therefore intelligence? Is it emotion relevant to music expression or not? And finally, a very obvious level of artistic relativity is our personal taste formulated by a variety of factors. And in this case, if beauty is in the eye of the beholder, so is intelligence. So summing up the problems of a musical Turing test and generally artistic behavioral criteria, there's the possibility of plain imitation, the subjectivity of intelligence, behavioral measures, and theories of mind, there's our psychological inclination named intentional stance, and there's also the added relativity of notions like art and music. And these problems hold also in the case of musical improvisation Turing test, since the as-if argument and the possibility of an imitation still hold due to the fact that spontaneity can be imitated, and the musical improvisation system run programs, therefore they fall within the scope of the Chinese argument, the Chinese room argument. And second, the controversy over the notions of intelligence, music and art, and subjectivity of our musical taste would respectively lead to controversial ontological and aesthetical evaluations of a given mechanic sound output seeming to be an improvisation. So, with our conclusions, machine intelligence can be verified or refuted by the Turing test or any other behavioral criterion. Even in its musical version, the Turing test fails at providing us with some consistent and clear results. Our turn to the musical, or generally the artistic version of the Turing test, was due to the fact that we treated art and music as something external to the study of mind. However, being a product of mind, the musical phenomenon is part of the problem and not a solution of it. The second conclusion is that the more we focus on the premises of the Turing test, the more we realize things about our judgment. What is really judged in a Turing test is judgment itself, human judgment itself. Thus, we could have a transcendental turn that would characterize the way that we are going to use the Turing test in the future. We should use the Turing test as an educational and a research tool and not as an intelligence criterion. For instance, we could have musical versions of the Turing test that could be used to study human psychology of aesthetic judgment in human-machine interaction with regards to music. This is a possibility. Our third and final conclusion is that the robo-ethical issue of attributing moral status to robots, for instance, the right of authorship, presupposes the attribution of intelligence to the machines, which in its term seems non-solvable under either the organic criterion or the behavioral criterion in all its forms, artistic or not. This is also the case with a more general adaptation of a more general machine-centric view in roboethics. So there's a final question. Given the epistemological limitations mentioned above, which could be the best way to face the machine-centric issues of roboethics? And there's a proposal. If we can actually be the machines, if we can actually witness the possibility of machines having mental states, we can have their first-person perspective, if it's there, we might at least try to imagine being the machines, employing what we have always been using to construct societies and live well with them, our empathy, our social cognition toolbox. And this brings us to John Rawls's The Veil of Ignorance. This is a thought experiment according to which the ideal society would be one that would come up if people were to choose its features without knowing beforehand their position in it, with a dreadful possibility of not belonging to the privileged part of the future society. They will decide in a way that will consider also the less privileged part. So let us imagine in our case, our future self is placed behind a non-transparent veil. Its non-transparency is due to the rapid and unpredictable ways in which technology evolves, but also due to our inconsistent criteria of intelligence. We don't know our place in the future society and the future moral taxonomy. We also can't know whether machines are intelligent or not. We might find our species in an unprivileged part of the society, or we might do wrong to the machines without even realizing it. So how do we decide to decide our future moral taxonomy? In the absence of enough data, using the veil of ignorance could be a way not to mistreat and not to be mistreated. The eyes of all future generations are upon us, and some of these eyes might not even be human. Thank you.
Do we have any human questions?
Or mechanic ones. Maybe it's the same.
Non-human questions? Reveal yourself. Yes.
Thank you for this very rich presentation. So actually, I've independently thought a little bit about this, but not with all this depth. So there are two things I would like to ask. First thing is, looks like in your treatment of the Turing test, you emphasize a lot the idea that programs are programmed, and that there is some kind of epistemic relation between the programmer and the program. And it seems to me that in deep learning, this epistemic situation is really different. And I think it has some effects in the dialectics of this question, although I'm not sure that it totally changes the conclusion you reach. But I would have expected like to include that in the discussion, because all the issue about surprise, well, in deep learning, we are surprised anyway. So this is going to be...
I mentioned this fact earlier.
Okay.
There are many kinds of programming which we cannot really anticipate what...
But
going
I think
to be
this is
output.
Different from stochastic introducing.
No, we also have unsupervised learning and deep learning programs. Yes.
And the second question is something that is not you mentioned at the beginning, but I think you left out of the presentation for obvious reasons because you cannot treat everything.
Yeah.
Is a criterion of being a living organism for moral status. So
this is the organic view, and I try to attack to this view, showing that all the criteria that have to do with the organic. Objection are arbitrary.
But
and this is the problem. All our criteria that we've been posing with regards to this intelligent, non-intelligent distinction are arbitrary. They are metaphysical. At the end of the day, the whole discussion becomes metaphysical. We've been using all these words, sentience, consciousness, self-aware, with very confidence. But if you have a really detailed look, there's a lot of arbitrariness. We've been using this in our everyday lives. We haven't put them under scientific scrutiny yet. And this is going on in the AI field still.
My question was a bit different. It was not about the organic criterion for intelligence. It was the idea of grounding the idea of having moral status, like moral interest, on being a living thing. So the argument would be that, like tools, like artificial entities, even though they could be intelligent, they could have like very high cognitive properties. There's no point of having them having some moral status because they are not living, so they just not have the basic interest of like pursuing their own lives. So
your question is whether we should attribute moral status to machines because they're going to be very high intelligent. Is this the question?
The question is, let's look at the idea of being a living being as a precondition for moral status.
So how can you define a living being? How can you define the limits of the living being condition?
I think there are some gray cases, like for viruses, but I think it's pretty clear that computers are not living beings.
Why should we limitate the whole discussion about morality to living beings and not also to mechanical beings that they can interact with us in an intelligent-like way? They're going to interact with us in various ways, and there's a possibility that they will claim for some more space in the future. This is rather a dystopian view, but we have to consider it. So it's not about living. We have all these barriers, these epistemological and categorical barriers and limits, but if we take a closer look to these limits, they're arbitrary, both for humans or machines or other living entities. Thus, we have constructed all these really nice buildings that they are on shallow grounds, because at the end of the day, it's all metaphysics.
I don't think metaphysics is arbitrary, but we can discuss that I guess.
It is, because you can adopt some metaphysical stance, and now you can adopt other metaphysical stance. Another metaphysical stance.
Other questions? Yes, please.
It's a wonderful talk, both parts. Thank you. About the roles application, I thought that was so interesting. As you well know, Rawls's idea there was that behind the veil of ignorance in a human society, we won't know whether we're on the bottom or the top or the middle of the socioeconomic scale. But that implies that we can think of ourselves as being less advantaged than we now are. The analogy would be that we can now, or would the analogy be, as you use it, that we can think of ourselves in the future as being somehow entered into a computer, for example, or we can now think of ourselves as being the robots. Because if you think about that application of the veil of ignorance, then we would have to be able to see ourselves as being sort of downloaded into a computer. Is that what you have in mind, or is the application
not
different?
Really downloaded to a computer, but get into other entities' shoes, as we say. This is our empathy extended also to mechanic entities. Our theory of mind also extended into mechanical entities. And there's a question, why should we do that? We normally don't do that. But there's another question. Do we have really solid criteria for not doing this? For not doing this, yes. We don't have solid criteria for that. I would also like to make a comment, if I have a minute, listening to all these brilliant talks. There's the issue of collective experience and collective intelligence and extended mind theory. This is obviously very familiar to you, but in the field of mechanic ethics, machine ethics, and especially the field of neuroethics or bioethics, this is still news. We are left with Kantian ethics, with utilitarian ethics, with sometimes virtue ethics, which pose a rather individualistic approach to ethics and intelligence. And there's nothing about collective intelligence and extended intelligence. So it's rather annoying the fact that philosophers working in different branches of philosophy seem to have evolved at a different level in terms of what they are discussing and they are acknowledging. Maybe we should have a more interconnectivity between different branches of philosophy and interdisciplinarity.
Let's make an interface.
Why not?
Thank you, Yorgos. Thank you, Anastasia. Let's have a 20-minute coffee break.